Okay, good afternoon. So we are here for the Octavia hands-on lab. My name is German Eichberger, and I'm joined by my colleagues from Rackspace, Adam Harwell, Franklin Neral, Trevor Waterman, Michael Johnson, and the gentleman walking here is Stephen Belikov from Blue Box, an IBM company. And I will hand over to my colleague Adam, who will do the first few slides, followed by Stephen, then I will do the whole demo. And thanks, guys, for showing up.
All right, as German said, I'm Adam Harwell. I'm from Rackspace, and I'm an engineer on Octavia. I'm going to be helping you guys through the lab a little bit today. I'll be wandering around while German actually tells you what to do. So you'll see me kind of in and out. And as we go through, just if you're having an issue, just like raise your hand or something. And we have a few people who will be wandering through and trying to help answer questions and get you going. So for the intro here, see, how do I actually advance the slides? There we go. OK. So we'll be doing I'll be doing a quick pre-intro. Then I'm going to pass it off to Stephen in a minute to give an architecture overview and dive a little bit deeper into the actual components that Octavia uses. I don't know how many of you made it out to the LBAS talk yesterday. We went over a lot of the same stuff, but we're going to dive a little bit deeper into that in his section. And then we're going to go directly into some operations, so how to actually spin up a load balancer in a few configurations. We'll do just a little bit of looking at the configuration of Octavia and get you used to the actual low-level components. And then we'll go into some troubleshooting steps. And so first of all, so we're going to actually be giving you some VMs to do this in. But if you have a DevStack instance set up already, this is what the screen looks like on Mac for VMware Fusion, just as an example. But whatever you're using, make sure that you have VTX enabled or nested virtualization enabled. Otherwise, it'll be really slow. And I know, which one doesn't support this?
VirtualBox.
Yeah, VirtualBox doesn't support this at all. So it's going to be a little slow. But you shouldn't fall behind because the VMs that we have don't have Netshoes virtualization either. So this is going to be it's going to be a little interesting. But we're going to start off by, I think Franklin here is handing out VM info. Did you already get everybody, or are you just starting?
Does anyone not have it yet? You can raise your hand if you don't have credentials to get into the VM.
Everybody has a credential?
Perfect. Okay.
Excellent.
OK, yeah. So yeah, you're going to log in as root on these. These are all Rackspace 8 gig general purpose instances. So they're pre-set up with DevStack, with Octavia actually already installed. So it's a little bit of a difference from what we showed on the slides. We opted to do that just because the time is somewhat limited, and we wanted to really get into the meat of things and not get stuck on what's essentially just what DevStack does for you. So for these VMs, you're going to log in as root with the IP and the password that's on that little slip of paper. And then immediately, pretty much just su-stack. And that'll put you as the stack user. I have some init scripts set up there that, like, just by logging in, it'll run some stuff. One of the things it does is set up, it sources DevStack's OpenRC admin, which makes you essentially gives you an environment where you're set up as the main admin user for DevStack. So all of our instructions are going to assume that you are set up with your environment with admin.
Just for the purposes.
Yeah, just for the purposes of this demo, just makes things a lot easier. And the first thing that we're going to have you do once you get in there is do a load balancer create. Because as I said, these aren't nested virtualization enabled, so this is going to take a while. So we're going to start off doing that, and then I'll pass off to Stephen, and he'll do all of the walkthrough of the components while that's happening.
So that command that you see there, the neutron LBAS load balancer create --name lb1 private subnet, do that immediately because it's going to take a number of minutes for that to get going. That's the longest step in this process. And we're going to have that run while I talk about the actual architecture of Octavia.
Yeah, and actually we have, it's there's going to be some long commands that are kind of finicky, so it might be easiest to copy-paste them. So I'm going to flip back here. If you didn't already go grab these slides to follow along, I recommend doing that. We've got a QR code there that you can just like load up the page, or it's a pretty easy short URL, bit.do/Octavia-slides. So hopefully everyone gets those open now. And if you don't get that and we move on and you need to get to it later, I can walk around and help you load those up. So again, you're probably going to want to have those open somewhere. So give it another couple seconds for that. Okay. So yeah, with that, I will be walking around again. So if you have any questions at all, just raise your hand and we'll get somebody over to you to help. So passing it off to Steven for the architecture.
Okay. So as you all know, Octavia is a open source load balancer for, specifically meant to work within the OpenStack environment. It makes use of several other OpenStack services in order to accomplish the actual task of delivering a load balancing service for the tenant. So I'm just going to go through this slide and discuss what all the different components are of Octavia. Some of these will become important. If you're used to working in DevStack, for example, you'll be able to see some of the processes that I describe in your DevStack when in the screen session they have there. So starting with the upper left, we have Neutron and the load balancer version 2 user API handler in the Octavia driver. So within there, that means that so the Neutron services daemon is actually running the API for Neutron LBAS version 2. So again, if you're in your dev stack, you can see it in there. It's also one of those things that in Adam's script that actually sets up the VMs that you're working on. Once you enable the features for I think it's what QLBAS or something like that, that gets enabled. And then when you enable Octavia, it enables the Octavia driver. So again, all of the command line stuff that we're going to be doing is going to be using the Neutron CLI because we're actually talking to Neutron LBAS version 2. And then on the back end, once the CLI, does its thing, it sends it off to the Neutron API. Neutron API then sends it to the LBAS V2 subcomponent, which then sends it to the Octavia driver, which then sends it to the Octavia API, which is the first thing after you get out of Neutron, you're talking to Octavia. Octavia itself, the actual control components are made up of four different daemons. The first is the API, which is obviously the front end that we meant. Eventually we're going to actually have a CLI that can talk directly to Octavia. Right now, you can, as a user, talk to the Octavia API, but if you're actually looking at this lab to figure out how to run this in production, it is not recommended right now to expose the Octavia API because it doesn't have any authentication yet. That's actually one of the things that will happen in Newton. So right now, you want typically you're going to want the Octavia API to be running on the same box or within a controlled network environment, so only the Neutron LBAS Neutron daemons can actually talk to the Octavia API at the present time. Anyway, so the Octavia API and the Neutron LBAS API are actually very similar in design. That is by design because they were sort of designed in tandem. Anyway, so looking at that, the Octavia API again is its own daemon, and it can communicate to and from the database for doing sanity checking and so on and so forth when you actually issue a command to Octavia. And to actually talk to the other components of Octavia, it uses Oslo messaging, so basically a rabbit queue. So Octavia API takes in the command from Neutron, sanitizes it, makes sure that we haven't got anything in there that is improper input, and then it sends it on the queue for the Octavia worker. The Octavia worker is a daemon by itself again, and that handles basically receiving messages from the API and the orchestration of setting up amphora and actually deploying services on the amphora, altering how the services are configured based on CLI commands or commands from the client. In this case, the amphora is probably, if you're not familiar with Octavia at all, then amphora is probably a term that is new to you. Amphora is actually a Latin term, and it means container. Actually, it's a big jar that they used to ship wine in back in ancient days. The reason why we didn't just call it container is because, well, it's a VM in some cases, it can be a container in other cases, and eventually we're thinking people will probably do this on bare metal devices as well. But the idea is they're dynamically created and dynamically launched. There's actually, as part of the DevStack script, one of the things that it does in there is it actually creates a VM image using Disk Image Builder and OOO based on software that is within the Octavia repository. So you get an amphora image, and when Octavia API and then the Octavia worker get a command to deploy a load balancer, they actually go out to Nova and have them launch an instance based on the compute nodes, which will be the container that actually runs the load balancing services. And when I say the load balancing services in this case, right now it's all HAProxy still. So it's all amphoras run HAProxy, and we have our own interface between the Octavia control components and the amphora themselves to do command and control with them. So anyway, getting back here to this diagram. So the everything, by the way, we've tried to abstract everything out so there's driver layers all over the place within Octavia so that you can actually replace certain components with other components depending on the specifics of your environment. We figure that most people who are planning on using this software pretty close to as is will probably need everything that's in there, but we of course wanted to make sure that if you have vendors with a proprietary technology that they want to apply that can do it better than the open source one, of course we have driver layers in there so that you can specifically replace the open source component that we're distributing in the Octavia project with whatever driver you want. So again, Octavia worker, it handles, again, commands from the API, spins up, shuts down, whatever, and reconfigures load balancing services depending on what the CLI says. And then once, if you're running normally, the amphoras will put off heartbeats every, I think, 5 seconds or something like that, which then the health manager intercepts. It gets those heartbeats, and that's how it knows that the amphora in the end is actually still alive. If those heartbeats start failing, and suddenly we go for a certain period, which I think in DevStack is 60 seconds, but in production you might want to adjust that value. But if it goes for a certain period with no heartbeat, we assume the amphora is dead, then we take action to replace the failed amphora with a new one. So the service should be self-healing in that regard. If you have, you know, a hardware failure within the cloud, you know, Octavia will notice that and spin up a new amphora and reconfigure the services you have on it. There's also, so there's a couple different modes in which Octavia can operate right now in the amphora specifically. The first one we did was, of course, just standalone, so you have a single amphora that runs a single load balancing service. But now in the Mitaka release, we also have active standby, which means that for every single load balancing service that you deploy, every load balancer that you deploy, there's going to be two amphora. One of them is going to be master, one of them is going to be backup or active in standby. And if either of those fails, then the health manager will notice it and replace the one that failed. If the master fails, then the standby will be promoted to the master. Just between the two, the actual controller components here don't even affect that. It's a pretty fast failover, usually within a second or two. When the health manager spins up the new amphora, it'll automatically make it the backup because we don't want to cause another blip in the front end client traffic that's going through it. So you'll notice here also that everything that I've talked about is all just sort of control stuff. We're not talking about data plane stuff. The data, you know, the actual requests that come into the front end of the load balancer and then go out the back end to the back end servers, that all happens on the amphora itself. So you can actually lose components of the command and control layer and it won't interrupt the end services the clients see. That's obviously not ideal. You want these things running all the time, but that is one of the features of the way Octavia works. It is all of the control is not in the data path, so it's pretty nice that way. Okay. The other thing is we also have a housekeeping manager, which manages if, for example, you've just shut down load balancing services or deleted a load balancer and you have an M4 that's now empty. The housekeeping manager will notice that and kill it, and that, you know, frees up compute resources. Michael, I think there's a couple other things that these do as well. Did you want to say anything about, I'm missing, or GermanCon? So.
Okay, so the housekeeper does two more things. We have a mode where we use spare pools, so you can configure that the housekeeper manager will bring up amphoras which are not configured yet. When you do then the failover, it happens much, much quicker because you just configure them, don't have to Nova boot something. Or when you want to bring up new load balancers, that happens much, much quicker when you have a spare pool. The other thing the housekeeper manager does is we talk to our amphoras via REST interface, which is with TLS protected. And if you guys know, TLS certificates expire, and the housekeeping manager will automatically reissue new certificates and replace expiring ones. So.
Yeah, so that's actually a good point. I forgot to mention that, yes, everything that comes from the control layer to the amphora is over a load balancer management network, and it is encrypted with bidirectional certificate-based authentication and encryption. So whenever we launch an amphora, for example, one of the things we shove into the new amphora is a certificate that it's going to use to communicate with the with the control layer, and the control layer always uses a certificate, and both ends do the authentication to make sure that we're, you know, so that the control layer knows that it's talking to the correct amphora, and the amphora knows that it's getting commands from a trusted source. So,
let's get into it.
Oh, you want to go ahead and get into it? Okay.
Yeah.
I was going to mention two or three other things.
Okay.
Real quick, okay. So the other thing is, again, for TLS, we make use of the Barbican project for people to store their certificates, so that if we need to like launch a new amphora, well, the amphoras that are doing the TLS termination need to know the certificates, but we let Barbican manage the storage of those. Of course, the compute driver is how we actually launch the amphoras. We talked to Nova for that right now. And then for any of the networking stuff, by the way, all these amphora right now, they will hot plug into backend server networks, I'm sorry, tenant networks, in order to connect to the backend members. And all of that is happening through the network driver, which talks to Neutron. So there you go. And OK, off to German now.
Hey, here you go.
Can I get? Okay, so let's talk about the operations you want to do. And the first thing we wrote down is you need some demo VMs, which will build the load balancers. So let's see if it all works. Here I'm in DevStack running on my local machine. And usually we can just copy things. So let's see if it works. So I did everything we said earlier. Just do that. Then it starts a VM. Oh, it's the thing about, so you start the other VM.
This is so we have backend servers.
Okay, you're good. So yeah, that's for the backend servers, which will do the load balancing. You can do a quick Nova list, look what's going on. See, they're both active. That's because they're zeros, which is really quick. So what happens a lot on my system is when I do those things that they don't work. See, so what you need to do then is, I think it's sec group list. And then you will see that the default one is that. Copy that. And let's set default, we need to put in this ID, which is the annoying thing when you run as admin sometimes. But Adam reassured me that on his VM that won't happen. Okay.
So yeah, actually, there's if you are having problems with any of these commands up here, there's a secondary example that's slightly different that you can compare against that I know should work on specifically on that VM, and that's in .profile in Stack's home directory. So if you cat that or vim that or whatever, you can see I have a bunch of scripts set up to do basically the same steps that we're doing up here. So yeah, if you have any problems with these scripts, check out those, and maybe you can see some hints. But yeah, still raise your hand, and I can come help you too.
Okay.
But be careful, because it'll be ever so slightly different. So if you start using those, it might cause problems if you try to switch back to these.
OK, then let's go to another Nova list, because I forgot the IP addresses of those things. And we want to start a web server there. So to get in there, just SSH into the address. And then you have to say something like cups win. And it's in the slides. Then you can go in there and copy our script, which will be a load balancer, which will be a web thing. Exit to the other one, 10.04. Okay, and then we run it again. Now we should have, if we did everything right, should have web servers running. You see it has this, and then we have that. So now the things are probably very, very fast. So did you guys get to that place, or are people still working on it? So who has this web server running? Cool, one.
So I've had a couple questions about the security groups, because there's three defaults in that VM. For now, just add that rule to all three of the defaults. That's just to get us through this demo. Again, the security groups are there to actually protect stuff. But for the purposes of the demo, we just need to be able to talk between the VMs. Obviously, you wouldn't do that in production. But again, we're just trying to get through this demo.
Or you can figure out which one you're using with the Nova Sec group list command, if you want to do that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So hopefully it's getting better. If you guys want me to move on, can do that. So you should have done this neutron command right at the beginning, the load balancing grade. So I'm doing that here for me. That will take a while. So just starting that. Okay, let's show you guys the command to check the status, which is neutron, which should also be a little bit further down. LBAS load balancer minus list. And because I'm running VTX on my box, it's up. I don't know, that should have happened for you too if you start right from the beginning.
Okay. Does anyone still, when they run that list command, are you still showing it as pending create? Or are people still seeing active now? Well, let me put a, I guess, show of hands for who sees it as active right now on theirs. Oh, good.
Okay.
Anyone still with pending create on theirs? Okay.
Okay, wait, so when you do the next thing, and it would be pending create, you will get an error.
If it's pending create, the next command won't work.
So what we now do is listeners. That's basically, so we create a load balancer, which is the IP address you are at, and then you want to put listeners on it, which represent the ports. We want to make an HTTP listener, so we're putting something on port 80, listener create, load balancer LB1, we're telling it on which load balancer, and then we say telling the protocol, which is HTTP, and most commonly, that runs on port 80, so we tell them that too, and name it listener1. So then that happens. The next thing you need is a pool. So it's a listener, a pool, and then you have to add your members. So let's do that, pool create. So basically, to create a pool, you can say which algorithm you like. I like round robin a lot. We can do other ones too. You need to tell it which listener it's going to, listener one. but there's also a way to do shared pools, which we see later. Then the protocol on the pool is HTTP, and the name again, pool one. So when we are there, now we need to add the members. And this requires us to remember where our web servers were. Let's see. And it was 10.003 and 10.004 in my example. Free. Takes a while. 10.004. And you see there's also, when you look at the bottom of this output, there's a weight. So in case you would have a much more powerful member than the other, you can change the weight. So requests go to one member more than to the others. So let's curl that. Let's go back to our curl command. I think it should be on 5 or 6. Let's see. Yeah. When you do it again, it comes to 4, which is what round robin does. So you see every time we curl it, goes to 3, to 4, to 3, to 4. So this is how you set up a load balancer. Let's see if people got that far. Okay, so who got there? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so we should probably wait a little bit more before we move on. Okay, so we probably want to move on to the next thing. So we did a HTTP load balancer, but the world is going to be secure. And so we want to set up a TLS load balancer as the next one. Or basically, we set up a TLS listener under the same load balancer. And the way things work in our system is we store all the certificates in another OpenStack project called Barbican. And so we need to figure out where it is, and we prepared every VM with a certificate is already there. So when you do this Barbican secret container list command, it will tell you there's a certificate, and it tells you the secrets, the private keys and stuff, and no consumers because nobody's using that right now. What's of interest is and that's done in a way I don't like it. That is this container href, the container href you see. So this is the thing you need to pass into your listener. So Octavia or Neutron LBASV2 knows which certificate to use. So and we loaded them up for you because you're not a Barbican workshop. So you need to look there. Okay, let's see. Next command. We create another listener, which is supposed to be the TLS listener. And you see here, I put in container href. This is this thing from above here. So you have to copy that, copy, paste. A lot in computers is about copy paste. So if I did that right, that will come up, terminate HPS. Again, we need a, over there, claiming we could use that pool. Let's see if that all works. Ah, a copy paste error. Okay, so we create another pool for the HTTPS. Then we have to add the members again. And since I did it already, I go back in my command buffer. Did I pool two? Then we go and add the other one, which is on three. And then we can go back to our curl. And this time, so I will show you something. So when you do it that way, then it says you can't verify it because we have a self-signed certificate, so you have to do curl minus k or install this stuff. Then it says that. But how do we know that it's actually a certificate we did? So we do curl minus cv. And then we have it's done on localhost. And you can look at a CN and stuff, self-signed certificate, and so on. You also see we went to four, so again the round robin. That's how we can do a TLS. One of those other great features. And what happens with Octavia is the TLS gets offloaded to the Octavia system. You have seen we didn't have to change the web server. It's still a web server returning stuff on port 80, but now we can do TLS, and so all the TLS workload is handled by Octavia. Okay, let's see who has a TLS load balancer running. Our TLS listener here, good. Two people. Okay, let's, so let's move on. The next thing I wanted to show was L7. L7 is a feature we introduced with the Mitaka release. So it's brand new. And it's basically that you can redirect things to different pools. And so we start with creating a new pool. And we want to create this pool. When you look at it, we didn't give, when you look at the pool create command, last time we did, every time we did a pool create command, we specified a listener. We didn't do it this time because it's a pool we want to use for L7. So we had to specify, instead of a listener, we had to specify a load balancer. See that here. All the other commands, with all the other pool create commands, we had to specify a listener. And now we specify a load balancer, which means it's a pools are now shareable in Mitaka, and you can assign listeners later, or you can assign L7 rules. So let's for one of our members on this pool, only one, so we can see a difference. Maybe we use 10.003. And then we have to create L7 things. So, and the way L7 works is, for those who haven't been in yesterday's talk, you can create one or n L7 policies, and they can contain one or n L7 rules. L7 policies, if you have more than one, they are connected with OR, so it's the first one or the second one or the third one. Whereas when you look at the rules, they have to be and, so all the rules have to be true that a policy gets executed. So when we say here we have a very simple policy, and you can and can do much more sophisticated things. But here basically we are creating a policy on the listener one, calling it L7 policy one, and two important things are the action, which we say is redirect to pool. So when it matches one of the rules in that policy, we will redirect it to the pool. And we specify as the pool it should redirect to, the pool three we just created. And we are attaching it, this L7 policy, to the first listener. And then we want to put a rule on it. As I said, the rules are and. And here what we want to do, we want to create a new rule. A couple of things you can do. You can do path, cookie, and so on. And we want to put it on the path. Want to say it starts with, and when it starts with slash lab, the URL, then we want to redirect it to this other pool. So that's done. Now when we do our curl from before, not the HTTPS, HTTP curl, and we attach lab to it, to the path, then we see it's going always to the web server on 10.003. Before we had round robin, so when I go without lab, it will 3, 4, 3, 4. But when we add lab to it, will always be 10.003, since we only specified one web server there. And this shows that L7 works the way we wanted. So everybody has some load balancing stuff running by now? Okay, good. So this was the stuff what maybe end users might do to set up load balancers and listeners. Now we're getting more to the things an operator might do. And let's get some information about the one amphora we have. So as we said earlier, the amphora are normal Nova VMs. And so we can do as admin, of course, you can do a Nova list, and then you see here my amphora, and my Nova VM, which houses the amphora. It's active, it's running, and there are a couple of things. So it has this private thing, which we then mapped to the VIP, and what's more important for us right now is it's also on our management network. So all the amphora get booted in our management network, and that's how we can talk to them. And we will do that now. So go. And we have an agent running on that, which you can talk to. And somebody's standing in front of my projector, Adam. Yeah. Okay. So basically, you can So basically, we keep the certificates, at least on dev stack, into etc Octavia certs client PAM. And
pause you for a second.
Okay, pause me.
So really quick, I know there's a lot of people having issues with the security group step. Who has still not gotten past getting the security group set up to be able to SSH into your member nodes? Is there anyone still not there yet? Okay, cool. That's good. If you still need help with that, just raise your hand and let me know. I just wanted to make sure we could move on because I think we're getting a little bit ahead.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll talk a little bit more about our agent interface. So we put in a bunch of commands like info, which will. So if you're an operator, you want to know what version of HAProxy I'm running, you can check that out, which host name, which API version. Also have other commands like details, which is pretty neat. So this is talking straight to our amphora. And here we get all kinds of information. So we get something about the CPU, the disk space. We can monitor how many HA boxes are running, what's the load is on this box, how much memory, what networks we have. And we didn't implement the packages thing, so. And which topology you're running, like single. You can also, if you want, you can also see what's going on there, how many, the listeners you have. Let's see if I can do that. So this is all stuff you might use to troubleshoot if you don't want to, or you can't log into your M4. Okay, so here you see all the listeners we have. We have like the HTTP listener and the HTTPS listener, so two listeners. You can even get more info by putting in the ID of a listener. So hopefully that works. And then it tells you about members, pools, status up. So here you see no check because I was because we didn't define health checks on those, health monitors on those members. But if there would be health monitors, you would see the status of those checks. So this is a very good way if you need to look into things and figure stuff out without using the Nova API. So the other way to learn more about the system is by just SSHing into this amphora. Let's find our IP again. Okay, so this is a little bit tricky. So you can configure it that it installs an SSH key on each M4, so you can SSH, and we do it on dev stack for debug and everything. But if you're running production, you might not do it that way. Depending on what you want to do. But anyway, so we store the private key to log in Octavia.ssh, Octavia SSH key. Then you can just log into an amphora. Mm-hmm. And once you are in, you can check on a bunch of stuff. So we have the agent, which we talked to so far. Let's see how it's doing. And then you see, the amphora agent is running. So we put it in as a system service. You can also check on HAProxy, but then you would need the listener ID. So the way we start them up is per listener. We start an HA proxy. And you need to know the listener ID, which was here somewhere. Let's pick one, like this one. Proxy listener ID. So this is how we name those. And then you see there's one running for this listener. So if somebody comes to you and says, hey, my port 80 thing doesn't work, then you can go in there and see if the HA proxy runs for that. Okay. So this is what we can do inside DVM. Bunch of learning more about stuff. So let's see, are we at a point where we should continue or let the stuff settle?
Sometimes it's just because the VM is a little slow.
Some people got that on the end.
Yeah.
I remember all of them, so they're always fast. It's also commercially successful.
So the amphora image is created within DevStack, actually that's the same as it would be in production. So that image, you could potentially use DevStack to create it and then copy it to your production environment. It's a Ubuntu box. It's basically starting with, I think, just a standard Ubuntu file image, and then we install our amphora agent and HA proxy and a couple other things on it, just for standard packages. Yeah, you can do Fedora. The Octavia.com can reference either the actual image. excited, you're having a problem to kill you. So.
Interface I can
Hey, German. I've had a couple of questions about, people seem to be confused as to what the difference is between LBAS V2 and Octavia and where things are going in the future. Do you want me to talk about that for a bit here, German? Okay, so I'm sorry if I'm kind of interrupting the flow of what you're doing.
No, it's fine.
But LBAS V2, the API, is not going away. So if you're developing a cloud software or software which interfaces with OpenStack, you can consider LBAS V2 to be set in stone. Any changes to that API are only going to be additive at this point.
I gave you the...
Oh, thank you. Perfect. So we actually just had a discussion among the groups who maintain LBAS V2 and the Octavia group, which, by the way, there's almost an exact one-to-one correlation between the cores between the two groups. They're very, very similar. You know, the same people are developing the same software on both sides. In the future, you may see that a lot of the LBAS V2 functionality that is presently in that project in a separate repo may end up in the Octavia repo. At the same time, the Neutron LBAS V2 API endpoint is not going to go away, and it's not going to change. So we, you know, maybe in a year or so, we might end up seeing it be a straight pass-through to the Octavia API. But at this point, it should be safe for you guys to develop software which talks to Neutron LBAS V2. It's not going to change.
Yeah.
And on that note, if you're using LBAS V1, now is the time to get off of it. It's deprecated. It's going away.
Yeah, LBAS V1 is going away. But basically, the difference, as you said, is LBAS V2 up in the corner, and that's basically the API interface with all the functionality I showed. And if you go out and buy a hardware load balancer, which is compatible with LBAS V2, would work the same way. Octavia is basically a software load balancer you get for free from us and plugs into LBAS V2. So right. That's basically the difference. So if you're buying stuff, you get LBAS V2, buy your stuff, and what you see down there, where it starts Octavia API, all this stuff would be gone. It would be whatever, F5, A10,
yep.
And so on. And we are basically, Octavia's basically a... It's similar to a hardware load balancer or software load balancer, whatever
yes.
Those people are selling those days.
And if you're looking for where this code all lives, the stuff there under the little Neutron box, that's in the Neutron-LBAS project. Everything else is in the Octavia project. So. Yeah, so the Horizon integration right now does work with LBAS V2. There was actually a demo of that yesterday. So and everything we've done, except for the L7 stuff, and I believe some of the TLS stuff you can't do in the GUI yet. We're hoping that'll land in Newton. And that right now talks to the Neutron LBAS API and LBAS V2 API. And it will continue to do so for the foreseeable future. So yes, the Horizon GUI isn't going away either.
Yeah, so also the heat integration is up on LBAS V2, so in case you are wondering.
That's
so
true.
All the other software, Horizon, Heat, Ansible LBAS, Puppet LBAS, they're developing, it's all against LBAS V2, so it would work with any load balancer which is compatible with LBAS V2.
Just think of Octavia as like a load balancer appliance, like any other vendor out there, it just happens to be an open source vendor. Second.
To use the Octavia instead of Manila LBAS version 2 itself?
So Octavia is the reference implementation for LBAS V2 at this point. So that's sort of the thing. If you're not going to use Octavia, then you're probably going to end up using a commercial appliance to do your load balancing instead of Octavia at this point. The namespace driver does exist, but I think it's deprecated at
deprecated,
this point.
Deprecated, yeah.
So. The way that Octavia, like in the Liberty release, where you could do all of the LBAS V2 features using the model where it ran HA proxy right there on the network node, that is not the recommended way to deploy. And specifically, it's because if you do anyone doing TLS termination, that's actually very CPU intensive, and it's very easy to overload your networking box with doing a whole bunch of SSL sessions. This is why we do all of this stuff. The amphoras all live on compute, because compute is designed to do CPU intensive stuff.
So Octavia is the reference implementation. So if you download a dev stack or you want to do a ref, and the reason we have a reference implementation is they don't let you add new API functionality like L7 without having a reference implementation for that. So that's why we need a reference implementation. And we decided to make a reference implementation which doesn't suck, and so we came up with Octavia. because before you could do reference and do toy clouds, when you went somewhere, then, well, didn't scale, wasn't a lot of things. Okay, let's see if I can get this thing. God, what did I do? Break it. Okay, one more question. What other VM? Yeah, you can use LBS V2 at the same time as. Yeah, LBS V2 is the API, so you can use it with Octavia. There's a, you can even have Octavia alongside a NetScaler, whatever. You can use as many load balancers as you can afford. No, the amphora instances get created against the Octavia tenant, which is an admin tenant, and we usually, in our installations, we make unlimited quota, so. Yeah? It gets created as a Nova VM. So basically you can specify a flavor. And whatever you put behind the flavor, that's where it gets created. So if you think you have very good hardware for networking, just make it a flavor and specify that, and then all the VMs end up there we use.
And the flavor defines how much power they
have. It's a Nova flavor. So we do custom, we set up a custom Octavia flavor. So because, you know, when you don't make it custom and hide it, and end users might find it and change it and break it. Yeah, it's a Nova flavor. You can say how much memory you want, how much disk space, how much CPU, you know.
Okay, that is in the Nova. Okay. If you would have.
That has to be configured in Nova. We didn't want to invent another scheduler, so we think. So we believe Nova is smart enough to put things where they belong.
Got it. Thanks.
Yeah, and you did you talk about the anti-affinity already?
So if you do active passive, if you have a couple of topologies. One of them is active passive. Then if you do active passive, you might want to avoid putting two VMs on the same server or even the same rack. And so then you can use anti-affinity rules, which you also define in Nova, sort of. So you can tell them, I want to be on different racks, and then you slot it in, can configure that on our end, and then we create them. Then we tell Nova this anti-affinity rule, and then they put them on different racks, different servers, different data centers, however you configure that stuff. Anti-affinity, that's in Nova. Yeah, Nova has anti-affinity rules, and we have a field where you can put in a reference to this anti-affinity. I think they call it anti-affinity group or anti-affinity group or something. Okay. So there was a couple more things I wanted to show. Yeah, 20 minutes, right. Okay, where did we get in the operations thing? Information about the amphora. We logged into an amphora. Failover. Cool. So this is something which probably doesn't work very well on your VMs, just warning you. So as I said, there are a bunch of topologies we support. And basically, we have a the failover means that Stephen said, we have a health monitor which monitors the health of an amphora. So if an amphora dies and we don't get a heartbeat back, then we go and basically fail it over. So then we provision a new Nova VM with the same configuration, and then we delete the old one and move the IP over. And now, we said amphora are driven by images. So you have GANs images, which which we use to build amphora. Now it happens a lot, there's a security problem or something, and you have to make a new image. So then you kind of patch your image, use the latest Ubuntu or whatever, which doesn't have the security problem, but you're still running VMs with the security problem. And so you need to then kind of replace those VMs, those amphoras, with the patched ones. And this is what you would do by forcing a failover. And I want to show that. So how that works. So we go and we'll probably start with a Nova list. First of all, you get out of the amphora. Nova list. So this is something to watch. Okay. So here we have the amphora, and you see it's on 192 whatever 04. So we want to figure out which port it's using for that. You can do this. And then what we want to do is basically, so it's sending health information on this port to the control plane. Then we want to shut down this port, which then forces the system to not receive any. Where are we there? I think that's the ID when I see it right. We do that. So it goes down. So we could run the curl. And then we want to do an over list again. And it's still the one it is. Yeah, it takes a minute or something. The minute it notices it, it will. Yeah, really takes a minute. So it gives us some time.
Yeah, in DevStack, the timeout is set to 60 seconds. In production, you might want to adjust that.
Yeah, it depends. If you run active passive, you could leave it at a minute.
Yeah, that's true. In active passive, the passive node will notice usually within a second if the master goes down or the active node goes down, and then it'll take over. But this is just a single standalone topology that we're doing, which obviously isn't highly available.
No, it's still highly available because we fail over. So
right,
you just don't get 99.99999.
Right,
you
should not
get 99.95% or whatever percent.
Much larger than it can be. So the DevStack failover time, I think, is 5 seconds or more. It's longer, just as the default. But you can configure that in the config file.
Okay. So for people paying attention, now we have see the IP changed, and also probably the ID changed. So now we are running a new amphora. So it went out, provisioned a new amphora, and replaced the one we were running before. And it still is on the same address in the tenant network, so the tenant shouldn't have noticed anything. It was the same for him.
Well, except for, you know, a little bit of an outage right there.
Yeah, short outage. Yeah. Okay, so we talked a lot about topology. And the next thing we wanted to do is show you guys the configuration file. So we keep them on DevStack in Octavia Conf. And they are hard to read because they're blue.
Colon set bg equals dark.
Yeah.
You're in VI, right?
Yeah.
Colon set bg equals dark.
Set.
Space bg equals dark.
Bg?
Bg. Mm-hmm. Bg is in boy.
Oh, background. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
See how often I use those things.
Okay,
good.
There you go.
That looks
much
nice.
Better.
Very nice. Thanks. Okay, so I will go a few things because I'm try to cut a little bit on time to have more time for questions. So at the very beginning, if you want to debug, there's two settings: verbose and debug. They're both set to false, so your log files are not as big as they could be. But if you want to debug problems, So if you do develop, we often set debug up to true, so we see the debug logs. And when you set verbose to true, you get the info logs. And when you don't do anything, then you get a warning and higher. Yeah. then database, health manager, bunch of stuff. And somewhere talks about topology. Okay, so here's the topology options. If you like something like active passive or active standby, then you have to replace this single here. With active standby. Then of course, then you have to restart a lot of stuff. So you have to reconnect. The easiest way to restart things on DevStack is to reconnect to the screen. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff. And you see all our services here on DevStack. For some reason, we stopped running the housekeeping manager. But so we have OAPI, so we stop that, restart. We have controller worker, stop, restart. And the health manager, stop, restart. We detach. And then we could do active passive, so we need to create a second load balancer. So I will just do it very load balancer. Load balancer. Create. I'll go crazy. Two. So we are starting a new one, pending create. And now it has to start two amphora, so it takes a bit longer. Should be rather quick on my box since I'm running it as the VTX. So we're both active. We can look at Nova, what we ended up with. And you see we have now three VMs. And I think the top ones are the new ones, 6 and 7. And they built this active-passive pair. Oh, 12 minutes left. Well, so anyways, so we probably should, we probably need a listener there quick. Listen to create. Probably not LB. let's go crazy, do a TLS listener. Pool. So, I guess. I think I didn't change the name. So you can also use IDs for things. Oh. Now we are in pool 2. Then member, put some members behind it. That's not a good sign. That's because I need to do HTTPS. Okay, that works. Now we want to find out who the master is. I want to use the easiest way to quickly go into the database and check for that. So there's a better command in the example. But you see we have our standalone load balancer we did before. We have a backup, we have a master. And now we see the master is on 192.168.0.6. And then if we go and probably should make that more impressive. Okay. God, was it watch? I did something wrong. Okay, there we go. Hopefully it does what I wanted to do. Oh, no, it doesn't. Gosh, need to do HTTPS. Okay, connection refused is annoying. But whatever. Why does it do that? Ubuntu open. Does it need to be. Maybe. Let's see if we can get that open the list. At 7, that's why. Gosh. So now we are in business. Then we set. So which one did we say was the master? Was the 06. So which, that's this one. Now we do a Nova delete, which is the fastest one to get rid of things. Then when we do a Nova list, then we should see that we only have 2 amphora left. And we see on the other screen that it's still working. There was a small blip, but other than that, that was what it took to do the active-passive failover. Now, since we did a Nova delete, the system won't automatically build a new amphora because it thinks when you do a Nova delete, that's what you actually want, get rid of things. But yeah, that's active-passive. Then I think we have 7 more minutes. There's a bunch of troubleshooting stuff. We talked about a log level. I showed you how to restart things. So there are log files. Probably should there are OpenStack logs. Should probably show you that too. And all our op files, our log files start with O something. And so there's OAPI, which is the API log files. OCW is the worker log files, and HM is the health manager log files. You can look at those when you want to troubleshoot and see what's going on. Then you can look at the log files on the amphora. I killed that one, that's why. Probably 5. So on the amphora, we also have log files, and we store them in a place called upstart. And this is where we keep the amphora agent log files. So this is where you can learn more about how our agent works, what it's doing. When you look there, it talks about all the requests it gets and what it has to do. So if we need to debug something, that's a good place. And what else do we want to show? Octavia database, I showed it briefly. And how to contribute. I actually wanted to have Michael talk about that, but he's busy, so I will talk about it briefly. So we are an OpenStack project inside the Neutron Stadium. And we have weekly meetings at 20 UTC in OpenStack Meeting Alt. We have our own IRC channel, which is OpenStack LBAS. And there's almost always somebody there, but not always somebody who can answer questions. There's always somebody there asking questions. And then we have a bunch of websites. We have our wiki, Octavia. We have our own Octavia.io, where we keep our proposals and documentation. We have a launchpad area. And we have a GitHub area where we put all our code. And we are always happy for people to join us and help us write better code, test it, and whatever. So if you guys are now excited about Octavia, want to help, Wednesday or other days in our channel. Okay, so we have like 4 minutes left for questions. Any more questions, stuff I didn't answer? Okay. Yeah. Cool. Then I guess we are. And I guess I give you guys 3 minutes back. You can still keep playing. Thanks, guys, for coming. And so it was a blast. Thanks. Yeah.